أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم أولم يروا إلى الطير فوقهم صافات ويقبض ما يمسكهن إلا الرحمن إنه بكل شيء بصير أمن هذا الذي هو جند لكم ينصركم من دون الرحمن إن الكافرون إلا في غرور أمن هذا الذي يرزقكم إن أمسك رزقه بل لجوا في عتو ونفور أفمن يمشي مكبا على وجهه أهدى أمن يمشي سويا أمن يمشي سويا على صراط مستقيم قل هو الذي أنشأكم وجعل لكم السمع والأبصار والأفئدة قليلا ما تشكرون قل هو الذي ذرأكم في الأرض وإليه تحشرون ويقولون متى هذا الوعد إن كنتم صادقين قل إنما العلم عند الله وإنما أنا نذير مبين فلما رأوه زلفة سيئت وجوه الذين كفروا وقيل هذا الذي كنتم به تدعون قل أرأيتم إن أهلكني الله ومن معي أو رحمنا فمن يجير الكافرين من عذاب أليم قل هو الرحمن آمنا به وعليه توكلنا فستعلمون من هو في ضلال مبين قل أرأيتم إن أصبح ماؤكم غورا فمن يأتيكم بماء معين صدق الله العلي العظيم
In the name of Allah, the Most Kind, the Most Merciful. Surah Al-Mulk, verses 19 to 30. Have they not seen the birds above them, expanding their wings and contracting them? What is it that withholds them except the beneficent God? Surely he sees everything. Or who is it that will be a host for you to assist you besides the beneficent God? The unbelievers are only in deception. Or who is it that will give you sustenance if he should withhold his sustenance? Nay, they persist in disdain and aversion. What, is he who goes prone upon his face better guided, or he who walks upright upon a straight path? Say, he it is who brought you into being, and made for you the ears and the eyes and the hearts. Little is it that you give thanks. Say, he it is who multiplied you in the earth, and to him you shall be gathered. And they say, when shall this threat be executed if you are truthful? Say, the knowledge thereof is only with Allah, and I am a plain warner. But when they shall see it nigh, the faces of those who disbelieve shall be sorry, and it shall be said, this is that which you used to call for. Say, have you considered if Allah should destroy me and those with me, rather he will have mercy on us? Yet who will protect the unbelievers from a painful punishment? Say, he is the beneficent God. We believe in him, and on him do we rely. So you shall come to know who it is that is in clear error. Say, have you considered if your water should go down? Who is it then that shall bring you flowing water? Salawat.
Brothers and sisters, just a few announcements before we continue with the main talk, as the speaker is slightly delayed. Tomorrow's program is the Ashura program, which will begin at 11:45 in the morning with A'mal. This will be followed by Dhuhrain prayers, and then after Quran recitation, a short talk by Shaykh Hassan Roushandel. This will be followed by the Maqtal recitation, including Marthiyah and Matam, and the Niyaz will be served at about 3:20. For those who have registered to collect Niyaz, collections available from 3:20 till 4 o'clock. We'll then be having Surah Yasin at the Woodcock Hill Cemetery, and the Shama Ghariba program begins at 8 o'clock in the evening with Dua Kumail recitation, followed by the main program as it is on a regular day, including today, with Salaah at 8:45, followed by a Quran recitation and the main talk. We're still collecting for the Muharram donation fund. If you'd like to make a donation, please speak to one of the executive committee members or make a donation via the website, sicm.org.uk. The approximate cost of the Muharram program this year is about £8,000. We still have a way to go to meet the fund, so please do donate generously. We're also still collecting for the Salaam Center Fund. As I'm sure many of you are aware, the basement works are, the structure of the basement has been completed, and we're now looking towards starting phase two soon, with the superstructure, hopefully bringing the facade into view. Please do donate generously towards this as well. Again, speak to any one of the executive committee members or make a donation online. Thank you.
We're privileged today to be joined by Shaykh Hassan Roushandel, who will be continuing his series on divinely inspired self-esteem. Shaykh Hassan Roushandel was born in the UK, graduated from Qom Hosa in 2017, and graduated from a master's in legal and political theory from UCL. He lectures at the Islamic College in Hosa of England and is currently working as a certified family mediator. Can we welcome him with a salawat?
أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم وبه نستعين وهو خير ناصر ومعين ثم الصلاة والسلام على أشرف الأنام حبيب إله العالمين أبي القاسم المصطفى محمد وعلى آل بيته الطيبين الطاهرين المعصومين لا سيما بقية الله في الأرضين. السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. Dear brothers, sisters, esteemed scholars, and thank you very much for inviting me here tonight. I'm very happy to be among you. I tried my best to make it tonight in person. We had to go through some, you know, ups and downs, but alhamdulillah, we managed to be here. So I'm very grateful for this opportunity, and inshallah, we can make the most out of it. First and foremost, myself, and inshallah, everyone else here. Please recite a salawat. Last night, we had a discussion on divinely inspired self-esteem. For the first few minutes, I'm going to summarize what we mentioned yesterday, and inshallah, we'll continue the discussion. Yesterday, we said that we hear a lot about the different figures we have in the Shi'i tradition, in the Muslim tradition, first of all, and then in Shi'i Islam. We have the Prophet, we hear a lot of stories about the Prophet and what he did. We discussed about Imam Ali alayhi salam and a lot of stories that we hear from Imam Ali alayhi salam and Imam Hussein. Very clearly, we discussed lots of stories that we see that the scholars, the lecturers, describe to us what is it that they did. I mentioned last night that it's important to know what they did. Maybe it's also important for us to focus on another aspect, which is how were they like that led to what they did. So this is like a step back. So we take a step back, we say, okay, this individual did X, Y, and Z, but it's also important for us to know what is it that led them to do this. Is it a particular characteristic they have? Is it a particular action? Were they reciting a dhikr, for example, every single day for this many times that, for example, led them to have this very, I don't know, strong confidence? Or, for example, led them to have a particular characteristic, quality, that then helped them in the position that they were, let's say, in the difficulty, whether it was a test, whether it was dealing with other people? What was it that they did that developed their particular characteristic that helped them in what they did? Because it's easy for us to get stuck into stories and say, okay, this is how the Imam was, so I want to be like that. But what is it that made him do what he did? So we started with this, and then we said, okay, we're going to focus on self-esteem and divinely inspired self-esteem because we are Muslims. Now, believe it or not, Islam, or accept it or not, Islam has a very great influence in our lives. So having said that, we mentioned that there are certain teachings in Islam that if understood correctly can be a boost for self-esteem, and if understood incorrectly can be potentially detrimental to a person's self-esteem. We then went to certain topics that we discussed last night. We started with the topic, does anyone remember what topic we started with? I'm assuming that probably the crowd is the same crowd, but it's fine if, you know, there's new people, perhaps. Does anyone remember what we mentioned last night? Okay, taklif, yes. So the first thing we started with ahkam and taklif, right? Ahsantum. Do you remember what we said?
Choose what they do rather than be assigned it or allocated it.
Ahsantum. So we said that it is important for an individual to feel the sense of autonomy and agency, even when it comes to following certain rulings in Islam that have been made wajib, or staying away from certain ahkam that have been told us that this is forbidden and stay away from it. It's important for this person to feel the agency that, hey, I am making a decision not to do this act. I am making a decision to pray. I often say that, you know, even when we want to pray salat, you can see that there's so many times we say that, for example, it's close to the time that the prayer would be qadha, and then we say, hey, by the way, I have to pray. Even this phrase, I have to pray, is indicating that there is this force that not necessarily I want to, but I have to do it. Even when it comes to using certain words, it's perhaps better to use words like, I want to pray. Why is that the case? We said that because God created us in a way that we have the sense of free will. We said everything else is almost predestined in one definition of it, other than the fact that God went out of his way to make sure that we have that sense of that there is no force to us. Yes, we do have ahkam, but then ahkam in a way that God says, this is wajib, this is haram. But before that, he says that no one can force you to do it. You need to make a decision. So it needs to be basically consciously. That's one of the things we mentioned last night. And then we went to the discussion on... Anyone remembers? Then we discussed after ahkam, the ahkam there's wajib and haram, even when it comes to this idea of there is a perfection, there is somewhere you need to be at, there is an example put in front of you to say, for example, the prophet, right? The imams, you see they're perfect in all different ways. This can potentially, we said, be detrimental to a person's self-esteem. Why? Because you look at that example, you say, that's what's expected from me. If perfection is expected from me, then when I look at myself, I know I'm basically nowhere near that. There's so many things about myself that I know that is nothing close to what the imams are. So if we portray the ahkam as something which is expected from me from day one, we said, which is basically perfection, or the examples of the imams to say that this is what's expected from you from day one, and then not say that this God who has made these ahkam wajib, haram, that has made it haram and wajib for you, he's the same God that has made or basically given us the principle of la haraj. La haraj means no, there's no taklif in the position of excessive hardship. So the same God that puts an image of this perfect being and wants you to reach that position, the same God says, hey, there are times in your life, لا يكلف الله نفسا إلا وسعها. There are times in your life that ما يريد الله ليجعل عليكم من حرج. God does not want to inflict excessive hardship on you. So if we introduce one side and not the other side, we said that we can potentially make a person feel that this God is always standing here. He's looking at us, he expects perfection from me, but not understanding that there are times in my life that I may go through difficulty and hardship. And in those moments, the God that I need to basically lean back on, the God that I need to basically talk to and to seek support from, he is not there for me because he expects the perfection. So these religious concepts, these are very normal religious concepts, right? But they can be potentially detrimental to a person's growth if they are not positioned in the right way, taught in the right way, understood in the correct manner. They can be potentially harmful. Iman of a person, right? So often we may say that, okay, let's develop iman, faith. Faith is something good. But when you look at the Quranic literature, not necessarily. There's this verse, it's beautiful. the verse is basically talking to people, not people who do not have iman. No, this is addressed to people who have iman. And it's kind of going back and forth with them. And then the end of the verse says, say to them, قُلْ بِئْسَ مَا يَأْمُرُكُمْ بِهِ إِيمَانُكُمْ إِن كُنْتُمْ مُؤْمِنِينَ. If you are mu'min, بِئْسَ مَا يَأْمُرُكُمْ بِهِ إِيمَانُكُمْ. What a bad thing this is that your iman is commanding you to do, is making you do, right? So we're talking about mu'min people who believe in religion, believe in God, believe in the imams, practice. But it can be the case that sometimes your iman takes you to a place where you may feel limited. Now, specifically for our lecture, it can do so many other things. But in our lecture, we would like to focus on those cases where it can potentially limit your self-esteem, right? And the self-esteem we're talking about is a divinely inspired one. So the first two nights, the reason why I'm talking about misconception is because, look, if I come and say, okay, there's this many times of dhikr, for example. Let's say this many times of dhikr. Say, mashallah, say, hasbunallah wa ni'mal wakil, if you are in this situation. But that's not going to work for most of us. Why is that the case? Because we have wrong understandings about so many things. About God, about relying on God, about tawakkul, about tafwidul amr to God. What's the difference between tawakkul and tafwidul amr? These are things, inshallah, we're going to discuss tonight. To have the wrong, right understanding of God, of religion, we're trying, right? It's not like I'm giving like this, you know, there's a revelation going on here. At least I don't feel it if it is going on. But it's just, you know, trying to reach an understanding where this God that is, you know, portrayed for us, we get closer to the right understanding that the Ahlul Bayt are trying to teach us. So the second thing was we discussed the principle of haraj and how ahkam can be supplemented with that, so that the God that expects you to do the wajibat, basically refrain from the muharramat and go beyond that, that's just the basics. To reach ma'rifah, he's the same God that understands that there are certain cases where you're just in excessive hardship. He understands that and he just takes off. He says, hey, look, you can pause. I don't expect anything from you. Just take care of yourself because you have a long journey ahead of you. And basically, as a form of a support for that. So this was the second thing we discussed. Then we got to this very nice discussion on basically trials and tribulations. I'm not sure if we covered it last night or not, but we got to a point where we were discussing, what was the exact, I think happiness and sadness, we got to that point in the Qur'an, and I think we didn't cover that, correct? We got to a point where one of you asked a question, it was a very interesting question. I wanted to kind of explain a few things about that question that was asked, and then hopefully we go to the new topic. The question was that if, you know, we are meant to be inspired by God and develop a strong level of self-esteem, then why is it through our narrations and du'as, the imams always put themselves down? They say, for example, we are haqir, we are miskin, I am a nobody. And how are we to read these du'as and still remain confident, still remain positive even? When you look at the du'as, this was a question for me for a long time. I personally couldn't connect with the du'as very much, especially when it got to the very negative ones, because it was definitely not me saying it with my own tongue. I don't know about yourselves, but when you're reading du'a kumail, or when you're reading, for example, Munajat Sha'baniya, there are parts of it that could possibly be like, hey, this is not me, right? Like, I would like to believe in this, but I probably haven't reached there yet. So when you're reading the du'a, are you really reading the du'a with your own language? Are you addressing God with your own tongue or not? I personally didn't feel like I'm connected. But then I came across an interesting explanation, which for me was satisfying. What was that explanation? It was that when you're reading the dua, you're not talking to God with these words. You're reading these words, but you're saying to God that this was an experience that a great person, great personality, went through. And in that moment, he was so connected to God that these are the words that came to his tongue and he really meant it. When I'm reading it, I am reading it. Number one, I'm trying to learn to see that what does it look like when you're in that position? And then you suddenly say to God, Ya man arjuhu likulli khair. Wow. Like, you can really reach there? That you have hope to God for every single khair that exists in this world? Wa amanu sakhatahu 'inda kulli shar. Wow. You feel safe of his wrath in all the instances of shar that I do? Well, I thought that this God, he's like very unstable, right? Sometimes we portray God as this, he's got this very unstable personality. He's an attention seeker, that the moment I do something wrong, he suddenly distances himself from me. And the moment I do right, he gets closer. So very unstable, very unpredictable, even in some cases. But this dua kind of teaches us a greater understanding and says, look, if you don't have the right understanding of God, then God would be a burden in your life. Let's be clear. In order for you to understand this statement, it's hard to understand it when you look at yourself and look at Shias. But it's very easy. Just look at other religions, right? For us, it's very easy. We say that, okay, other religions, they're all batil, you know, how people often speak. So just look at other religions. There's so many other religions that believe in God. And then look at their lives and you feel like, oh my God, ooh, their God tells them to do X, Y, and Z. Yeah, that's very limiting. I just feel sorry for them. I don't want to name certain religions, but it's very easy for you to think about it. So the same thing can happen to you if you have the wrong understanding of God. When it comes to the topic of tests and tribulations, trials, why does God test us? Well, not many people have the right answer for this. A lot of us think that God tests us because he needs to know which one of us do right and which one of us do wrong and which one... But these are very simple answers. And if you really believe in a God that needs to test you in order for him to know whether you're doing right or wrong, now then, imagine you're leaving your home, you're trying to go and live your life, and you're always in this complexity in your head. You're like, the moment a test comes, you're like, oh God, not again, not now. Seriously, you can't let me have one moment of happiness. You have to ruin it with something. Because this is the perspective. Again, you can be Muslim, you can be Shia, you can live your whole life with these perspectives. And trust me, I don't think anyone's going to stop you and say, hey, why do you have this perspective? If you don't pray, people will stop you and say, hey, why don't you pray? Pray. But if you pray incorrectly, no one's going to stop you because they're not going to know. So we do have this issue that we are... I'm not even going to say if it's good or bad, but there are some things which are the apparent side of religion, which if you don't do, people can clearly point at you and say, hey, he's not practicing, he's practicing. But then there is a depth to religion that if we don't have that, no one's going to find out. And we're going to live our lives very normally and without even feeling sometimes that there's something missing. So when it comes to tests, if that's the perspective, then... it can be an issue. It can be an issue for your self-esteem. Why? We define self-esteem. We said self-esteem is the sense of value. How can you feel valued? Seriously, how can you feel valued when the one who created you is standing right there behind you and tests you for no reason, and the moment you feel happy in your life, he suddenly comes in. It's like he knows when to get you, right? It's in lots of traditions or in cultures, they say, don't get too happy. Why? Because God is going to make you sad after that. I don't know if you have it in your cultures, or many cultures apparently have this. So when you get too happy, don't get too happy because sadness is going to come right in from the back door. Who brings the sadness? God, because he doesn't want you to be too happy. Why? So interestingly, these people find narrations and verses for what they say, because when you go to religion with one mindset, you can find narrations for this. So people who think sadness is default in religion, we need to be sad, we need to put our heads down, we don't need to, you know, there's too much laughing, too much happiness, too much joy. No, 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 put all of them aside. This is not religious. If you're Muslim, you need to be very, you know, always your head down. Don't smile too much, don't laugh too much. Or if you're happy too much, then you have to be sad as well to compensate for it. Those who say this, they say yes, they basically supply it with what? With verses of the Quran. The verse of the Quran says, إِنَّ الْإِنسَانَ لَفِي خُسْرٍ. Did you know that you are basically in khasara every moment, even when you're doing good? What does this do to you? There's a part of it that you're in loss. You're losing. And they just say this and say this so many times to you because they think that the moment that you're happy, you're ghafil, right? You're not thinking of God when you're happy. You can't be happy and think of God. So they bring these verses. They go to the narrations and say, "Ad-dunya sijnul mu'min." Dunya is what? The prison of a mu'min. And then they say, hey, don't be too happy. Don't want too much in this world. Just build for your akhirah. And then obviously they give solutions too. It's not that they don't, they just leave you there. They're kind, right? They really want good for you. No, seriously, a lot of the people who believe in these things, they want good. But the question is, what if we go to the Quran and we talk about huzn, we talk about sadness? What does the Quran say about sadness? What does the Quran say about basically huzn? When you go to the Quran, it's very interesting. You see, there's so many verses that talk about huzn and gham and sadness, grief. You want to translate it. You go to, it's very interesting. There's this verse about Uhud, the Battle of Uhud. The Muslims, they became greedy. They wanted the loots of war. They basically were really hopeful that they're going to receive a lot of money and wealth. But then it didn't happen and they lost. So the verse says, "Minkum man yuridu dunya wa minkum man yuridu al-akhirah." Some of you wanted the dunya, some of you wanted the akhirah, and then we tested you and so on. And then the next verse says to them, remember, إِذْ تُصْعِدُونَ وَلَا تَلْوُونَ عَلَىٰ أَحَدٍ وَالرَّسُولُ يَدْعُوكُمْ فِي أُخْرَاكُمْ. You were basically, you were leaving, you were going really fast. إِذْ تُصْعِدُونَ وَلَا تَلْوُونَ عَلَىٰ أَحَدٍ. You were not paying attention to anyone, you were basically running away. وَالرَّسُولُ يَدْعُوكُمْ فِي أُخْرَاكُمْ. The Prophet was calling you from behind. فَأَثَابَكُمْ غَمًّا بِغَمٍ لِكَيْ لَا تَأْسَوْ عَلَىٰ مَا فَاتَكُمْ وَلَا مَا أَتَاكُمْ. And what happened after this? He says, you were sad. Now there are different tafasir for this verse. I'm going to use the understanding of Allama Tabatabai here. He says that when it says أَثَابَكُمْ غَمًّا بِغَمٍ means you had a gham, you had a grief. What was the grief? We lost, right? There was this loss here happening. So we lost and we didn't get what we wanted. But this grief, God doesn't want you to go through grief. If there's something that you've lost, if there's something that you wanted but you didn't get, the moment you focus on it, you're basically attracting more grief towards yourself. So the moment you were focusing on it, God says, no, 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 no. What am I going to do? I'm going to replace it with another grief. But what is this grief? This is a grief which is holy. Okay? Now you may say, okay, so grief is positive in Islam then, huh? So it's fine to have grief. No. We're going to get to the conclusion. Just be with me now. So God says there was a grief which was we had loss, but no, that's not good. So God rewarded you with a grief which is good. What's this grief which is good? It's the grief of now you've realized what mistake you have done. Okay? So God has rewarded you with a new grief, which replaces the negative grief. Okay, so if you look at this verse, it just remains here. It says, فَأَثَابَكُمْ بِغَمَّنْ بِغَمٍ وَاي لِكَيْ لَا تَأْسَوْ عَلَى مَا فَاتَكُمْ وَلَا مَا أَتَكُمْ, so that you do not have grief and be sad of what has, you know, you've lost and you've passed. That's the past. Move forward. And then you look at another verse in the Quran, which says what? Which talks about a person who made a mistake, like these people in Uhud. They made a mistake, right? They left the Prophet, they ran away. So God says, now have the grief of, be sad of what you did. Realize. Now there's another verse that talks about a person who understood his mistake and had the grief. And look what God did to him. And we've mentioned this verse last night. In the other verse, he says, وَذَنُّونِ إِذْ ذَهَبَ مُغَاضِبًا. Yunus, he left his city angry. فَظَنَّ أَلَّن نَقْدِرَ عَلَيْهِ. In his mind, he was like, okay, he cursed the people and he said that he thought that we're not going to hold him accountable for this. He can do this and it's fine. But then he realized that was a mistake. God expected more from him. He realized that. وَذَنُّونِ إِذْ ذَهَبَ مُغَاضِبًا فَظَنَّ أَلَّن نَقْدِرَ عَلَيْهِ فَنَادَى فِي الظُّلُمَاتِ. Then he realized. What happened afterwards? He called upon God in darkness. أَلَّا إِلَهَ إِلَّا أَنْتَ سُبْحَانَكَ إِنِّي كُنْتُ مِنَ الظَّالِمِينَ. There's no ilah, there's no Lord but you. سُبْحَانَكَ إِنِّي كُنْتُ مِنَ الظَّالِمِينَ. I was from the people who oppressed myself. So, at this point, it's fine. You realize you were an oppressor. You made a mistake. But from this moment onwards, what does God say? فَاسْتَجَبْنَا لَهُ. The moment he says this, we accepted it from him. وَنَجَّيْنَاهُ مِنَ الْغَمِ. And we saved him from this gham. The gham was only there for you to realize that you've made a mistake. So if there is a moment of grief that comes, the grief which is allowed in Islam for you, it's the grief that you have from the mistakes that you have made. But if you continue this grief, if it's a continuous grief, the continuation of it is a su'u dhan billah, is that you have the wrong assumption to God and it's a sin after that. So you repent, you realize that. Beyond this, if you have the right approach, وَنَجَّيْنَاهُ مِنَ الْغَمِ وَكَذَلِكَ نُنْجِي الْمُؤْمِنِينَ. The people who have the right iman, the moment they have repented, they should completely forget. Because God has forgotten at this point. But if you continue for days and days, oh, I'm such a bad person. Oh, I'm such... Why? Because, you know, 1 month ago, I did this really bad thing. And would God really forgive me? If you have this perspective, what's going to happen to your self-esteem? You're going to think that you have a God that's going to hold you accountable for a sin you did 3 years ago. You've repented for it 100 times or more. But you still think that God is going to hold you accountable. He's always there and he's always going to remind you for this sin that you've done. How are you going to feel value, like your self-worth? Just imagine you have a creator who's dealing with you this way. Are you going to feel worthy? I'm like, gosh, like if it was my mom or dad, just once or twice, if I apologize from them, you know, they're just going to accept and they're never going to remind me of it. And I feel worthy. I'm like, okay, my one word of apology was taken seriously. But if you have a Lord, if you have a God, that as many times as you repent to him, your words are not worthy to him, this is going to increase in your sense of not being worthy. And not being valuable. But God says, I'm going to save you. And I'm going to give you the... I'm going to save you from gham. And I'm going to save every single person. This is how we nunjil mu'minin. We save the mu'mins. Please recite salawat. So this was regarding misconception we can have of religion regarding sadness and happiness. You go beyond this. God introduces to you, which we mentioned last night, God introduces to you that how the awliyaullah are now. Now, yes, mu'mineen, people who have brought iman, they repent and God saves them from gham. But how are the awliyaullah? And these awliyaullah are different from people who are just mu'mins. The verse says, introduces awliya Allah to you and see how it introduces them to you. Have this criteria in front of you. Because if you don't have a criteria, they're going to introduce people to you and say, this person is man of God. This person is an ilahi person. Is an arif. You go, you sit with them, they're always like frowning. You hardly see, in 1 or 2 hours that you're with them, you hardly see them smile. They don't pay attention to you. They're always sad. Or for example, you can easily trigger them. But you go to the Quran, أَلَّا إِنَّ أَوْلِيَاءَ اللَّهِ لَا خَوْفٌ عَلَيْهِمْ وَلَا هُمْ يَحْزَنُونَ. Allama Tabatabai says there are some scholars who tried to say that this verse is about Akhirah. Is about that the awliyaullah, the people, wali of God means what? Waliya in Arabic means something which is so close to something. So when you say one thing is the wali of the other, they're so close that there's nothing in between them. So awliya Allah, sometimes God can be the wali of people, people can be wali of God. Wallahu waliyul mu'mineen, God is the wali of the mu'mineen. And then here is awliya Allah, basically. Some people are the wali of God. God is their wali, they are wali of God because they're basically so close to each other. God says the awliya Allah are whom? They don't have la khawfun alayhim wa lahum yahsanun. They don't have khawf, fear, and they don't grieve. They don't have grief. Allama Tabatabai says some of the scholars try to say this is for Akhirah. In the day of judgment, they will have no fear because they are sure that God is going to give them, you know, everything. And basically on the day of judgment, they do not get sad. There's no huzn for them. Why? Because, you know, God is going to give them everything, basically, same thing. But he says this is a wrong understanding. Because what they're trying to justify is that they're trying to justify that the awliyaullah in this world, they will grieve, they will be mahzoon, they will be basically sad, they will have khawf in their heart. But he says, no, that's wrong. Based on narrations that we have, this is wrong. If you want to know the person who's the awliyaullah, la khawfun alayhim wa lahum yahsanun in this world. They don't have fear. Because fear is, so basically people usually fear loss, or there's so many different aspects of fear and grief, right? Sometimes you grieve things which you've lost. Sometimes you have fear of something that would happen to you in the future. But awliya Allah have certain characteristics which compensate for this, which we're going to go to the next discussion. What do the awliya Allah have? There's a concept of tawakkul. وَعَلَى اللَّهِ فَلْيَتَوَكَّلِ الْمُؤْمِنُونَ. And upon God should do tawakkul the mu'minun. Such a great concept. Again, there is a possibility of us to misunderstand this. There is a possibility of us to understand it correctly. The misunderstanding of tawakkul would be something that we perhaps see around sometimes. Is some people, instead of getting up and doing work, instead of having ambitions in life, sometimes you see the most mutawakkil people around you are the people who have the least level of ambition, least level of motivation, least level of wanting in this world. Like, what do you want? What are your plans? No, I do tawakkul on God. And he gives you this very nice smile. We say, you know, from a position of power, is as if, like, you know, God has given me everything. But then you see this person doesn't plan for anything, doesn't. There's nothing, literally. There's no motivation. What do you want in this world? No, I don't want anything that God gives me. This is the wrong understanding, and I'm going to tell you why. When you're looking at tawakkul, so there's two concepts we have. One is a concept of tawakkul. The other one is a concept of tafwidul amr ilallah. Tafwidul amr means I give God the authority to choose for me what he wants, what he wills. Level one is what we call tawakkul. Level two is tafwidul amr. What's level one? Tawakkul means I make a decision about what I want. Then I rely on God how I'm going to get to it. I'm going to plan, but I rely on God because he is the ultimate planner. But I know what I want. I'm firm about what is it that I want in this world. I am motivated. I'm going to go and do it. This is the first step. People who jump the first step and suddenly jump to tafwid al-amr make a mistake because they haven't gone through the route, the path. It's the journey, right? You suddenly want to jump from step one to step 10. You make a mistake of, instead of making, knowing what you want, you, without even choosing, without even sitting down and say, hey, what is it in this world I want? You jump to step 10 and you become a person who's not motivated, who doesn't do anything in this world, who's very literally a loser. A lot of the people who I see who, you know, there are some people I know that they don't plan for anything. And interestingly, some people call them, they say these are the most pious people. And you go to their family, you see their family is struggling and they're getting money from X, Y, and Z, borrowing all the time, trying. So for example, the wife is trying to sort everything out. But then the husband, you say, hey, why aren't you working? God gives the rizq, right? But then you see the family suffering. What's the problem here? If you do tawakkul the wrong way, well, some people may continue until the end of their life and not really understand or not really realize that this is wrong. But then if you do it the wrong way, what happens is that you do tawakkul in your life and then you see nothing coming. How many people have said this? Oh, but God, I did tawakkul on you, but then it didn't work out. So either tawakkul is wrong or I'm wrong. Well, I'm not going to admit that I'm wrong, so tawakkul is wrong. You get hopeless. You're like, God, you tell me do tawakkul. You tell me rely on me, but then it didn't work out. But then when you look at the right way of approaching it, tawakkul means you want something, you plan for it. Then what happens here, because at the end of the day, when you plan, they say that, wal abdu yudabbir, wallahu yuqaddir. You do your tadbir, you learn to do your ABCs, do go through your steps. But then often, what happens here is God comes in. When you even do your steps, God comes in and alters a few things. Just if you're lucky, sometimes we're not lucky and God just leaves us to ourselves and we go and we do, we become ghafil and ghafil every single day, day by day. But if God really sees you as a person who really wants to help you and you've, you know, you've said, you know, I'm Muslim, I want to get closer to you, those places when you become ghafil and you become too obsessed with yourself, God sometimes comes and changes things to see whether you, at the end of the day, go back to Him or not and ask Him for guidance and for everything, because you know, in our traditions, in our teachings in Islam, it's very clear that God is the ultimate planner. It's very clear that God is the one who decides. God is the one who he's the awwal wal akhir wal zahir wal batin, and he wants you to get there, to reach that realization. Now, coming back to tawakkul, if we get tawakkul, so step one tawakkul, step two tafwid al-amr. If you don't go through this path, you'll be someone who's lazy and will be attributing your laziness to tawakkul, which is wrong. You want to go through the right way. Step one, do the right tawakkul, which is doing all the plannings and everything. Then people reach a level. So after your life is sorted, you're planning, you got everything sorted, it's possible for a person to reach a level where they've asked an arif, what is it that you want? He says, the only thing I want in my life is not to want. So I want to not to want and let God decide for me what He wants. But that's the highest level. If you don't go from step one and practice the tawakkul, then get to tafwid al-amr, you'll face that problem, and then what's that going to do? That's going to result in resentment. What's going on in religion? What is this tawakkul thing? And you're potentially going to be able to even reject it or deny it if it gets to a serious position in your life. So this is the concept of tawakkul and tafwid al-amr. How many minutes do I have? Sorry? It's done? Okay. So, just to summarize what we mentioned today, the topic was the topic of divinely inspired self-esteem. We said that before saying what is it that can boost your self-esteem in religion, it's important for us to be able to dismantle those misunderstandings and misconceptions, the wrong mindsets and perspectives that we have about religion that can potentially be detrimental to our self-esteem, which is divinely inspired by God. We said it's necessary for us to be able to open those up and have a conversation. We talked about the concept of sadness and happiness, ahkam, and how do we deal with ahkam, about the principle of haraj, about, I think one or two other topics we discussed. And then what we're going to do, what we did tonight, we discussed the topic of tawakkul and the topic of tafweed al-amr. And there's one or two topics left I'm going to discuss, inshallah. And then we go to the point where how can we actually be inspired by religion? And what did the narration say? And how did the Ahlul Bayt look at God? And how did they see God in a way that God actually boosted their confidence? God boosted their self-esteem, self-worth. And inshallah, we will try to have a conversation about that. If there's any particular questions or comments, suggestions you have, I'm more than happy to hear. Please recite a salawat.
Assalamu alaikum.
Alaykum assalam wa rahmatullah.
So you started with saying that God does not want to put hardship on you. And then you said about the fact that if we say, I have to pray, that's the wrong attitude, because I want to say I want to pray. That would be the right thing to say. When you say God does not want to put hardship on us, well, I'm not sure. Because as a Muslim, I have to pray, and I have to pray, yeah? That's what I said quite clearly, yeah? And the ladies have to wear hijab, and then when we go out working, there's different things and different aspects. So it is not very easy being a Muslim. So is God actually putting hardship for us or not? Mm. I beg to differ that he is, yeah? So that's what I'm saying. So how do you, or do you agree with it?
Of course.
Good.
I agree. I agree that there are most of the perspectives that we can have from many different angles if we look at it. It's clearly hardship. Our personal experience shows that it's difficulty, it's hardship, it really doesn't make sense. But what I'm trying to say tonight is that there is a possibility for us to be able to reach a position, and that's what's wanted from us. The autonomy is very important, the autonomy aspect, for you to feel free, so that you can reach a stage where you would want to follow what has become wajib. And why is that the case? Because in the Quran, many times it says, وَلَوْ شَاءَ اللَّهُ لَجَمَعَهُمْ عَلَى الْهُدَىٰ. If God wanted, He would have gathered them. Just leave them alone. ذَرْهُمْ, right? ذَرْهُمْ فِي خَوْضِهِمْ يَلْعَبُونَ. Leave them, let them do whatever they're doing. Why? Because it's important for you not to force them and them to reach. Now, is it possible for us to reach? The way I look at it is that you need to feel free to do things in order to reach the freedom which Islam wants from you. The freedom which Islam wants is not freedom to do things, but it starts with that, because if you don't have freedom to do things, you're not going to have the freedom which Islam wants. What is this, the freedom which, in my very humble opinion, Islam wants, is for you to reach the level of freedom from, not freedom to. So free to is basically, I'm free to pray and not to pray. Exactly. You need to feel free to do and not to, and to not do, basically. But staying there, but that's just something that everyone has. It's basically, from our animalistic point of view, is basically we feel an agency. I want to do this, I don't want to do that. There's nothing to do with religion here. And religion shouldn't hinder this. But then where it wants to take you is for you to be free from. Free from following desires. Free from following things which are not godly. Free from. And how do you reach it is from freedom to do so. So I'm saying that there could be a perspective towards that. So when you're praying, if you feel like you're forced, yes, it's wajib, but if you don't pray, trust me, if you leave your house, no stone is going to fall on your head. If that's what you think, that if you don't pray, there's going to be a stone falling on my head before the dua very clearly says, وَآمَنُ سَخَطَهُ عِنْدَ كُلِّ شَرْ. This is dua in Rajab, right? I feel safe of his wrath in every position of shar, in anywhere that there's shar, that I'm doing shar, that there's shar happening, I feel safe. I know he's not gonna, his wrath is not gonna take me because of his love. And then in the continuation says, يَا مَنْ يُعْطِ الْكَثِيرَ بِالْقَلِيلِ يَا مَنْ يُعْطِ مَنْ سَأَلَهُ يَا مَنْ يُعْطِ مَنْ لَمْ يَسْأَلْهُ وَمَنْ لَمْ يَعْرِفُهُ تَحَنُّنًا مِنْهُ وَرَحْمَةً. O you who give whoever does not ask you and does not even know you, تَحَنُّنًا مِنْهُ وَرَحْمَةً. So if you feel like something is going to be taken away from you, especially in what you're experiencing in your life, if you leave praying, if you feel like there's going to be a stone falling on your head, then that's the wrong perspective, I think. You know, if you stop praying, you're going to see it's not going to fall.
I don't think there's any stone going to fall on my head. Sorry. My question was here very simple. Is God putting hardship on us? And you said he is putting hardship on us. And you're saying that he could leave us free to do what we want to. But in England, people can do whatever they want to. Yeah? Does that bring them to Islam? So I'm getting completely confused about what you're saying. Sorry.
Yeah.
Maybe sorry. I'm not understanding properly what you're saying, but I'm just completely at loss.
So I'm going to try to rephrase it. Maybe I'm not being very clear, but I'm saying that, so if you leave someone free, not necessarily they're going to become Muslim. Of course not. There are so many people who are free and they don't become Muslim. But in order for you to become the right Muslim, what Islam would want from you, and I'm quoting Shahid Beheshti here, when he's talking about teaching children, he says, he speaks to people, he says, okay, you want to know how to bring your children up. He says, bring them up as insan. And then he says, what is insan? What's the main characteristic of an insan? He says, bring them up as mukhtar. Mukhtar means autonomous. Why? Because the main factor as an insan is a person needs to feel like they have agency and they have the right to choose. He says, if you bring, you may be able to teach your children so many things, the way to act, you know, for example, dress this way, look this way, act this way, everything. But then this child may be brought up and may look like a manifestation of goodness. He says, like, you know, he will be a statue of, let's say, Islam or Muslims, but he's only a statue and there's no spirit in it. All I'm trying to say is basically if you leave a person free, they can choose and they, you know, they may choose and they may not choose. But there are so many cases where if you just feel you're compelled to do something, the sense I'm saying. So it's possible for someone to undergo hardship. If I go to the doctor and, for example, I'm taking a vaccine, I know that there is a possibility of me going through a lot of hardship and difficulty through it, whether it's fever after that, whether it's so many side effects. But if I make a decision to go there, the mindset is important, I'm saying. And I'm just saying that it's possible. Many of us may never live that life in this world. We may live, well, this is not a dua, this is a statement. I'm not saying may we live. I'm saying we may live a life of misery and die miserable being a Muslim. I agree 100%. But I'm saying there is a possibility of us not doing that. There is a possibility of us reaching a stage. This is only reaching a stage where we make a decision to follow things. Can I just say the story? I think it's a nice story. So, you know, in our religion, there is a recommendation for Salatul Layl, night prayer. I remember when I went to the Hausa, some of the teachers encouraged me so much. I was 16 and they told me, they said, wake up at night, force yourself, read Salatul Layl, it's good for you. I never bought it. I couldn't. And I was like, I can't. Like, it's, I need to know why, I need to know, you know, I need to really want to do this and I really don't feel like it. That's one aspect. You see, you encourage someone to do it, not focusing on what is behind the scene, what's going on, right? So not knowing why should I do this, how does it help me? I'm going to mention to you a story of one of the martyrs in Iran, Shahid Chamran, his name. He's a very interesting figure. I'm not sure if any of his works has been translated to English, but he's an interesting personality. He's someone who left Iran, went to America, studied there, I think studied nuclear something, if I remember correctly. And he was a very educated person. And then he went back to Iran and he was in the military and he was martyred. He says, his wife says this. His wife says that at nights when he was a commander in the military, at nights he would wake up and I would see him cry in Salatul Layl. And once I asked him, I was like, Mustafa, why? Like, what's the point? Right? What is it that you're getting here? Like, I don't understand. And he says to his wife, he says, look, during the day, the moment I leave my house, to leave the door, I have everyone bowing in front of me and everyone saying, you know, hey, commander, and respecting me so much. He says, in order for me to have the strength during the day and not lose myself and be God conscious, I need my moments at night. So you see this person makes a decision. So I'm giving to you an example of someone like myself when I was 16, when I was told, hey, go and do Salatul Layl, even if I had woken up. It's like, oh my God, this is so difficult. Oh gosh, And then I see an example of Mustafa where he wakes up and he wants it. And he says, I need this connection in order to be able to function during the daytime. So these are two examples. I'm saying that it's possible for us to be able to reach a place where some of the teachings of religion make sense to us. And we'd make a decision to want to do that. And that is where I think religion becomes very beautiful for us, inshallah.
Assalamu alaikum.
Assalamu alaikum.
If you don't mind, this is both a question and perhaps maybe an answer to the previous person as well. Yeah. In the words of Imam Ali alayhi salam, he talks about faith being in three aspects. Like someone at a beginner stage would have khawf, so fear. So it's kind of, I think my question was really going to say, did you mean it is a type of balance but growth? So Imam Ali alayhi salam says it's fear, and then after fear it is trying to win paradise, so it's a business state. And then the last stage is the state of love, that you do it fi sabilillah without any thought after that. So I hope that also answers that question in terms of it being stages. Like in, we might do salat, but we not understand why is it 2 rakat salat, why is it 4 rakat salat, why does it have to be that way? But it is there because there's a blessing in it, but we don't realize it until we go internally in the in the batin rather than in the zahir. Now, what I was going to also question whether that was what you meant, and at the same time I wanted to ask, when you say huzn, and in, for example, we have in the Quran this story of Ya'qub, and he's upset, but his heart isn't upset because he believes, he doesn't have ya's. I don't know if the word huzn is used, but he's grieving. He's constantly grieving for Yusuf alayhi salam. I don't know what word is used for Hazrat Maryam, but when she sees the angel, initially she has a type of fear. Same when Prophet Ibrahim. So how would you explain that in that sense of kind of how you put it, if that makes sense?
Yeah. It's interesting because you look at the Quran, one part of it says, Ala inna awliya Allahi la khawfun alayhim wa lahum yahzanun. Then the verse of Ya'qub says, Qala inni la yahzununi an tadhhabu bihi wa akhafu an ya'kulahu dhib. So there's huzn in it and there's khawf in it, right? So Alam Tabatabai says there are certain khawf and huzn which is accepted. So that's when it comes to God. However, I'm not going to say that Ya'qub's khawf and huzn was a godly one. I'm not going to try to portray that at all. But what I'm going to say is that no, that it's not black and white. It's not like this person is the waliullah and then suddenly he's not. There's levels to get to becoming a waliullah. And the more you get to the highest level, the more the fear and the more the huzn goes away. So when it comes to the stories of the prophets, we know that the prophets had made certain mistakes, some of those prophets. Mistakes, and these are not haram mistakes. These are just what they would call it tarkul awla, just leaving or not, or doing something which is not the best, or not being in the best position. And this could be one of those examples where Ya'qub had that. And that as a result of saying that, I am scared, وَأَخَافُ أَنْ يَأْكُلَهُ الذِّئْبُ, what happened? It came to him, because he was not meant to be scared of that, if that makes sense. When it comes to Yusuf, the same thing. When Yusuf says, so it all, it's so interesting, because apparently we have a narration, you know, when Yusuf says that I prefer, as رَبِّ السِّجْنُ أَحَبُّ إِلَيَّ مِمَّا يَدْعُونَنِي إِلَيْهِ or tad'unani ilay. The prison is ahabbu ilay. I want that more. I haven't checked this narration, but I've heard that there is a narration by the Prophet to have said that if Yusuf had not said Rabbi sijnu ahabbu ilayya, but said that, oh God, freedom is better than me, I would have granted him freedom. But he said sijn ahabbu, I gave him the sijn. Meaning what? That it depends on how you look at God and in that moment what you expect from Him. Because as I mentioned last night, أَنَا عِنْدَ ظَنَّ عَبْدِي بِي, right? I will give you as much as you have the assumption you have of me. Even Yusuf at some point said something that he could have said something higher and God would have given him something higher if he had said that, based on a narration. So do you see there's different levels? So it could be potentially that the level of Ya'qub at that point, in with that particular instance, he had huzn and he had khawf, which the awliyaullah, because that verse, sorry, it's a bit taking a bit long, just the last part. The next part of the verse says, Alladhina amanu wa kanu yattaqun. This ala inna awliya Allahi la khawfun alayhim wa lahum yahzanun. Alladhina amanu wa kanu yattaqun. Those people who brought iman and says it in a past tense, wa kanu yattaqun. They had taqwa and they used to constantly have taqwa, meaning that this level of being awliyaullah and having iman is a very highest level of iman. It's not the iman, because they brought iman at some point and they went through all the levels of iman and then kanu yattaqun, then they became the awliyaullah and with the yaqeen. So when you're at the highest, la khawfun alayhim wa lahum yahzanun, but then you have to reach and it's gradual. We hope, inshallah, if we set that a target, maybe it's going to take us 40 years. But we're hopeful that at some point, if we set that as a target, we're on the journey to reach the becoming an awliyaullah. So there's, when you look at it this way, again, it doesn't mess up your self-esteem because it's a process. Sorry for taking very long. I hope that kind of explained what you, the question.
I just wanted to know if you felt at all there was a different relationship between the zahir and the batin, so the physical world and the spiritual one. So for example, so let's give you an example of Imam Ali ibn al-Husayn. He used to always cry when he remembered. He had huzn, but it was a physical one. And if you read his du'as, he takes his worry and all his grief to God, and it somehow meshes into a more spiritual, that it doesn't exist, but it exists within the physical world. But when it comes to qiyamah, so what you were saying previously, perhaps that growth is actually qiyamah and to that point. So I don't know what you think about that in terms of...
Yeah, no, I agree. And Allama Tabatabi also says, there are some khawfs that are godly ones. Like, for example, you have khawf of God. The khawf, which is again explained in the correct manner. Not the khawf that, oh God, I'm scared you don't accept my repentance. No, that's just ridiculous because he says he does. There's some level of huzn that is also a huzn which is approved by God. And it's through God as well. So the huzn, for example, you have for the grief. You grieve for the, for example, events of Karbala. You grieve for things that God has approved you to. But that's very different to having huzn of something that you've lost. لِكَيْ لَا تَأْسَوْ لِكَيْ لَا تَحْزَنُوا عَلَى مَا فَاتَكُمْ وَلَا تَفْرَحُوا عَلَى مَا آتَاكُمْ. The Quran says, so that you do not have, لِكَيْ لَا تَحْزَنُوا, you don't have huzn of عَلَى مَا فَاتَكُمْ, what you've lost. وَلَا تَفْرَحُوا عَلَى مَا آتَاكُمْ, you don't become so happy of what you achieve. It's giving you, inshallah, in the next lecture, I was going to say that there is this kamil insan that has portrayed, that God has portrayed for you, that doesn't become happy. And happiness, it doesn't say it doesn't become happy. He says, You know, the moment you become so joyful is as if that, for example, you suddenly receive 100,000 pounds, imagine, and you become, oh my God, I'm so happy, so joyful. He says, no, your worth and value is so much that that 100,000 pounds is nothing. It should come and serve you rather than you serve the money. So you don't become happy, joyful out of your mind when you receive something. You don't become mahzoon out of your mind when you lose something. No, these are things that come and go, but you remain calm. And that's the calmness, inshallah, self-esteem will explain, hopefully.
Thank you very much. I think as time pressing on, we'll end the question and answer
session. We've gone over time a lot. Sorry for that. But there's a hand here. It's up to you guys whether that's something.
If it's okay, if there's time afterwards and you're around, then they can perhaps speak to you afterwards, if that's okay. Or we can continue and you can have the question tomorrow, inshallah. But I think we'll continue with the Masaib. Salawat ala Muhammad wa ala Muhammad.
Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ala Muhammad wa ajjal farajahum. السلام عليك يا أبا عبد الله وعلى الأرواح التي حلت بفنائك عليك مني سلام الله أبدا ما بقيت وبقي الليل والنهار ولا جعله الله آخر العهد مني لزيارتكم السلام على الحسين وعلى علي بن الحسين وعلى أولاد الحسين وعلى أصحاب الحسين الذين بذلوا مهجهم دون الحسين May Allah's peace and blessings be upon you. My beloved Prophet and the Ahlul Bayt. It was in your homes that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala blessed us with guidance and revelation. May Allah's peace and blessings be upon you, Ya Aba Abdullah. لا يوم كيومك يا أبا عبد الله لا يوم كيومك يا أبا عبد الله وسيعلم الذين ظلموا أي منقلب ينقلبون والعاقبة للمتقين والحمد لله رب العالمين صلوا على محمد وآل محمد
The desert is so quiet, there's a deathly calm. The night is so dark, don't be scared, Oscar. I hear that they gave you an arrow when all you asked for was some water. Oh my Asghar, you were bathed in blood. Oh my Asghar, you were bathed in blood. The night is so dark, don't be scared, Asghar. The desert is so quiet, there's a deathly calm. The night is so dark, don't be scared, Asghar. I only want to ask one question to the waters of River Furat. Couldn't you spare some water for my son? Couldn't you spare some water for my son? The night is so dark, don't be scared, Asghar. The desert is so quiet, there's a deathly calm. The night is so dark, don't be scared, Asghar. Come, let me change your blood-soaked clothes. Let me cradle you in my arms. What did they do to my Mujahid? What did they do to my Mujahid? The night is so dark, don't be scared, Asghar. The desert is so quiet, there's a deathly calm. The night is so dark, don't be scared, Asghar. I see your radiant face, the thirst on your lips. I couldn't even give you any milk. All my life I'll never forget. All my life I'll never forget. The night is so dark, don't be scared, Asghar. The desert is so quiet, there's a deathly calm. The night is so dark, don't be scared, Asghar. Oh Muslims, when you see infants being killed, killed and denied water, remember my Asghar, go to their aid. Remember my Asghar, go to their aid. The night is so dark, don't be scared, Asghar. The desert is so quiet, there's a deathly calm. The night is so dark, don't be scared, Asghar. Salawat.
بخانم لالایی
ای جانم
يا هلالي شفتك بدمعي وصفتك باسمائي أمي دمادا
علي علي
أمي دمادا
علي علي
أيهم شوكوسر
علي علي
أيهم شوكوسر علي علي من ودعتك يمشي يم بادي ديتا
علي علي
بادي ديتا
علي علي
داروز محشر
علي علي
داروز محشر علي شبها ذکرت به لبها کوثر بود
ای جانا
ای سهر اللیالی و دمع اللیالی علیک شهود ای گشت پرپر
علی علی
ای گشت پرپر
علی علی
بی فرش و بستر
علی علی
بی فرش و بستر علی علی انتظارم لحظه شمارم ای مادر
ای جانا
بین حال زارم من بی قرارم ای نوبه
ای جانا
ای لماه علبال و بدم لاجال تتعفر ای ماه انوار
علی علی
ای ماه انوار
علی علی
در بین اسکر در بین اسکر جانم علی
علی علی اکبر علی 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 اکبر علی علی شبه پیامبر علی علی شبه پیامبر علی علی
Ziyarah.
بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم السلام عليك يا أبا عبد الله وعلى الأرواح التي حلت بفنائك عليك مني سلام الله أبدا ما بقيت وبقي الليل والنهار ولا جعله الله آخر العهد مني لزيارتكم السلام على الحسين وعلى علي بن الحسين وعلى أولاد الحسين وعلى أصحاب الحسين السلام عليك يا أبا عبد الله وعلى جدك المصطفى وأبيك المرتضى وأخيك المجتبى السلام عليك يا أبا عبد الله وعلى جدتك الكبرى وأمك الزهراء السلام عليك يا أبا عبد الله وعلى أبنائك التسعة النجبى علي السجاد ومحمد الباقر وجعفر الصادق وموسى الكاظم وعلي الرضا ومحمد الجواد وعلي الهادي والحسن العسكري والحجة ابن الحسن المهدي السلام عليك يا صاحب الزمان عجل الله تعالى فرجك وسهل الله مخرجك وظهورك وجعلنا الله من أنصارك وأعوانك والمستشهدين بين يديك بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم اللهم كن لوليك الحجة ابن الحسن صلواتك عليه وعلى آبائه في هذه الساعة وفي كل ساعة وليا وحافظا وقائدا وناصرا ودليلا وعينا حتى تسكنه أرضك طوعا وتمتعه فيها طويلا وصل اللهم على سيدنا ونبينا محمد وآله الطيبين الطاهرين.